Good evening, everyone. Good evening, senior faculty, junior faculty, and dear residents. Today, we're going to have a small discussion on orthosis, prosthesis, and mobility aids. I'm Dr. Binish Balakrishnan, assistant professor at MFPMR, SNIMS. I want this to be an interactive session. So can anyone tell me the definition of an orthosis? Akhil, can you tell me the definition of an orthosis? You should answer quickly because there's a lot to discuss here. Definition of an orthosis? Definition of an orthosis?
Sir, it's a...
Yeah, Pawan, tell.
So it is an orthopedic appliance used to modify the structural or functional characteristics of the joint.
Okay, that's good, that's good. I can't proceed with the slides. What am I supposed to do? Press what? Okay, fine. Oh, okay, here we go. The orthosis is an external mechanical device applied to a body part to keep it in its functional or anatomical position. Okay, so Pawan, you're almost right. Now we'll start off with upper limb orthosis. Can you tell me what this device is quickly? Pawan or Siri or Akhil? Quickly. It's actually a wrist hand orthosis. Okay, what are the indications of a wrist hand orthosis? It can be divided into four classifications. Musculoskeletal conditions like tendonitis, tenosynovitis, brain injury, spinal cord injury, peripheral nerve injury, post-injury and post-surgery immobilization, and if you don't use an orthosis, burn injury. Okay, so post-burns immobilization is also an indication for wrist-hand orthosis. Pawan, this one, tell me.
Sir, this is a Cockup splint.
Very good, very good. This is a Cockup splint. There are on the left, you can see this what is called the dynamic Cockup splint. Okay. Yes. What about this one?
A knuckle bender splint.
Knuckle bender splint. Okay. What a functional splint. It keeps the MCP joint in 90 degree of flexion. It keeps the interphalangeal joints in complete extension. Okay. It maintains the transverse palmar arch and it also helps in prehension. Coming back to the Cockup splint, what is it usually used for?
For wrist drop.
Very good. Wrist drop either because of radial nerve injuries or because of stroke or whatever it is. So you can always start off with a static Cockup splint, and as the motion improves, you can go for a dynamic Cockup splint. Besides this, for post-surgical immobilization, you can use a Cockup. Okay. This I've already discussed about the knuckle bender splint. It is used for ulnar nerve palsy or for combined median and ulnar nerve palsy resulting in a complete claw hand. What is this device, this orthotic device? Anybody? Very good. Thumb spike. What are the indications of a thumb spike? What is Bickover vein stenosynovitis? BQ2S. Indication will be wrist sprain. Another indication will be metacarpal fractures. Okay, so now we're coming to the finger splints. On the left upper corner, what do you see? What splint is that? And what is it used for? Anybody?
For buttonnier deformity.
Very good. What is the name of the splint? It's called an oval 8 splint. Okay. It looks like an oval 8, right? That is why it's called an oval 8 splint. Okay. Now on the right side, on the upper edge, what do you see? What splint is that?
Mallet finger.
Very good. Mallet finger orthosis. Okay. Now on the left lower area, what is that? Think about it. It's not that difficult. You're taking too much time. It's actually a trigger finger orthosis, which can be used for immobilizing a trigger finger. Okay. Now the last one on the right lower end, what is that? Don't take too much time. Yes, finger cord splint. Very good. For finger all injuries. Cord. Yes, very good. Finger cord splint. For injuries of the fingers, ligament as well as bony, you can use that. Now name this orthosis.
Tennis elbow brace.
Tennis elbow.
Very good. Tennis elbow brace. What are the indications of tennis elbow brace? You can lateral use it for tennis elbow as well as golfer's elbow, that is lateral epicondylitis and medial epicondylitis respectively. Okay. What is this test over here?
Cousins test.
Describe the position of each joint in the Cousins test. Each joint. This picture is slightly wrong, but still, just tell me.
Elbow inflection.
What is wrong with the picture? That's why I kept the picture. It's the wrong picture. The elbow should be extended, then, okay.
Forearm pronated.
Yes. Pronated. Yeah. Then.
And dorsiflexion again.
Dorsiflexion and hand in a fist. Okay. Tenderness will be seen where? Yeah, near lateral epicondyle. Okay. Fine. What is the test for golf elbow? What is? Okay, forced wrist palma flexion will elicit pain near the medial epicondyle area or the common flexor origin. Now, where is this wrist? This orthosis worn. It is actually worn 2 finger breadths distal to the lateral epicondyle. Okay. Now, what is this elbow orthosis? Don't take too much. What? I can't hear. Yeah, hinged elbow orthosis. Very, very good. Now, hinged elbow orthosis is used for healing of elbow fractures, and the rehab protocol depends on the presence of concomitant medial collateral or ulnar lateral collateral ligament injuries. Okay, fine. What is this device? Very simple.
Sling and sling.
Yeah, shoulder sling. Shoulder sling. Okay. What are the indications of shoulder sling? It's very easy. It includes fractures. It includes injuries around the shoulder joint which require immobilization. It also includes conditions where the patient is likely to go in for subluxation. Okay. Now we're going to lower limb orthosis. What is this orthosis? Please tell me.
Medial arch.
Very good. Medial arch support. Arch, it's not a wedge. It's not a wedge. Don't get that wrong. Okay. Medial arch support. Now, what happens in the medial arch support is it either augments it, okay, or it completely replaces it, provided that it flexible. Okay, I'll give you a few examples where the middle arch support is used. Pes planus that is flexible can be managed with a middle arch support. Pes equinus needs a middle arch support. Valgus to a certain extent may need middle arch support. Besides this, hallux rigidus, hallux valgus can also need a medial arch support. Now in plantar fasciitis, middle arch support along with a good insole is usually helpful. Insole. Now insoles usually are made of microcellular rubber or microcellular polymers. Now they help in offloading the foot and are useful for a wide range of conditions, right from diabetic peripheral neuropathy to foot strain to plantar fasciitis, even osteoarthritis knee. A good insole has a role. Okay. Now, what is this device? Very simple.
Foot drop splint.
No, that is layman. Ankle foot orthosis. This is called an ankle foot orthosis. What are the indications of an ankle foot orthosis? We are starting from the right this time to prevent deformities, correct deformities in the presence of muscular weakness of the ankle and subtalar muscle areas where you can get foot drop and all that, to prevent inappropriate loading following an injury or because of a muscular weakness. On the left upper side, you are seeing the mechanism of a common ankle injury. What are you talking about? Very simple. This one. What are you talking about? Which injury? Yes, actually, it's an inversion ankle sprain. Okay. So in inversion ankle sprains, I'll just give you an extra piece of information. There's something called the police protocol. You know the price protocol. What is the police protocol? Anybody? What is the price protocol? We'll start from there.
Protection.
Quick, don't waste too much time.
Protection, rust.
Yeah. Yes.
Ice, compression, elevation. Yes.
Very good. So what is the police protocol? It's the same thing. Instead of rest, we are giving OL, that is optimal loading. Okay. So it is protection, optimal loading, ice, compression, and elevation. Now this orthosis, please name the orthosis. I'll give you a small clue. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Tell me.
Floor reaction orthosis.
Very good. Floor reaction, anterior floor reaction orthosis is the complete name. Okay. Now we have a part over here that prevents hyperextension. The angle is kept at 10 degrees of plantar flexion. Okay. And there is a part that prevents too much flexion as well. Okay. Now it's used in cases where a hand to knee gait is seen because of quadriceps weakness. What you have to remember is when you're walking and the foot touches the ground will exert a force upwards. That is called, against the foot. Okay. That is called the ground reaction force. Now, if the ground reaction force is anterior to the knee joint, it will help. And if it is posterior to the knee joint, it will cause flexion of the knee joint. It will assist in flexion of the knee joint. I'm sorry. So this is a hand-to-knee gait, okay. In quadriceps weakness, what happens is, if you can see this dotted line, it is going behind you. So it is going to assist in knee flexion. So the knee flexes with quadriceps weakness, the patient will have a buckling knee and will not be able to walk effectively. So what happens, if you see on the left side, the line diagram shows, sorry, I have to go back. The line diagram shows that since the ankle is in plantar flexion, the ground reaction force is anterior to the knee joint. therefore assists in flex, in extension of the knee joint. I'm sorry. The ground reaction force is anterior to the knee joint and assists in extension of the knee joint. Besides this, I had earlier shown you there is something to prevent hyperextension and also to limit the flexion. So that is how a floor reaction orthosis works. Okay. It prevents flexion of the knee and assists in extension by manipulating the ground reaction force as well as by using the different parts of the orthosis. What is this device? Anyone? Don't take too much time. Pawan, what is this? Okay, fine. This is a patella tendon bearing orthosis. Now, what happens is there are certain patients in which the amount of weight borne by the fibula, tibia, and the foot has to be reduced to a great extent. So, in patella tendon bearing orthosis, if you can see on the right side, the weight is borne by the anterior part of the patella tendon and also by the latex. So much so that nearly 75% of the weight borne by the tibia, fibula, and the foot can be reduced. And according to some experts, even 100%. If this PTB brace is modified, it is almost like non-weight bearing. Okay. Now, what are the conditions where we could use a patella tendon bearing orthosis? Very simple, actually. Whatever conditions are there below the knee, which need time for healing and all, we can use a PTB brace. So first, we'll go to the indications. Supposing we have chronic osteomyelitis of the tibia, you can use a PTB brace. Supposing there's a fracture of the os calcis, you can use the PTB brace. And supposing there is a delayed union or a non-union of a real fracture, you can use a PTB brace. But there are certain contraindications. If you have an unstable knee joint, you can't use a PTB brace. If you have an ulcerative lesion near the patella, if you have a weak quadriceps, you can't use a PTB brace. Okay, this is very simple. What am I showing here? Which ligament is getting injured?
Posterior.
Are you sure it is posterior?
Lateral
contact,
sir. ACL.
ACL injury, yeah? Okay, fine. What are the two parts of an ACL ACL ligament? Two parts are there, no? Two bundles are there, right?
Anterior medial and
posterior. Okay, which one is?
Sir, anterior medial.
Yes, okay. The pneumonic eye uses AMFM, okay? Anteromedial bundle is taut during flexion movement, okay? AMFM. Fine.
Yeah,
using these braces, devices.
Knee mobilizer.
Yeah, knee mobilizer on the right side. What's on the left side?
The knee cap.
What is it?
Brace, knee brace.
It's called a standard knee sleeve with a pad. Now, both of these, now the new knee orthoses, they have a few advantages. They provide better compression. They give better support and comfort. They are less likely to give you skin reaction and irritation and all that. Okay. And they are easier to don. So knee sleeve and knee immobilizer can be used for all these conditions for immobilizing the knee. What are these devices? Anyone?
Knee, ankle,
knee, ankle, foot, or
no, No, I'm looking for something. HKAF. Yeah, HKAF is there, KAF is there, but I'm looking for this particular class of device. Little more specific. You're not wrong by saying HKAF or KAF. These are called calipers. Okay. Now, calipers are low volume or orthotic devices. However, you should mention about the joints involved, the kind of uprights, the suspension systems, the modifications or the connections to the foot, if any. Okay. That is how you prescribe a caliper. Now, how do you check the alignment of a caliper? We start from the right upper area. The knee joint is supposed to be centered around the medial femoral condyle. Below is supposed to be centered around the medial malleolus. Now, in this picture, I only want you to see the hip joint. The hip joint should be such that it promotes and it is able to support 90 degree of flexion. Now we'll come to the indications of KAFOs and HKAFOs. Like you guys said, these can also be referred to as KAFOs and HKAFOs. Muscle weakness affecting the hips and the knees is one indication for using a KAFO and an HKAFO. Another one would be UMN lesions. Now what happens in UMN lesions is the control of the lower limb muscles is lost, right? So there you may need assistance with a HKAFO or a KAFO. Supposing integrity of the knee joint or the hip joint is compromised. It can be because of ligament injury, because of trauma, because of degeneration, because of inflammatory arthritis. Using an orthosis as this is an easy one. Come on, tell me. Don't waste so much time. This is very easy.
Dennis Brown.
Very good. Dennis Brown. Okay. Now, congenital talipes equinovarus is a very, very common congenital anomaly of the lower limbs. Now, what are the components? You must be knowing this by heart, but I'll just mention. The entire foot is inverted and supinated. The forefoot is adducted. There is a short foot. The heel is rotated inwards as varus and in plantar flexion as equinus. The thin calf muscles can be easily seen. There can be shortening of the leg. Sorry. In ambulation, the gait can be awkward. What is the Ponseti technique? Since we are discussing CTEV anyways.
Read the cavus, yeah. then adduction,
yes.
Then varus, and then equinus.
Okay, fine. Fine. Okay. Now, which condition are we treating here? Very simple. Very, very simple.
So, DDH.
Very good. Developmental dysplasia of hip. This is a hip abduction orthosis. Okay. Now, here you can see there are two splints. Which one is von Rosen and which one is Pavlik? Can you tell me?
The left side is von Rosen and right side is Pavlik.
Very good, very good. Okay, now these are the lines important in hip dislocation. I mean, sorry, dysplasia. Can someone tell me what Hilgen-Rieners line is?
There are line passing
the peridate
cartilage.
Yes, very good. What is Perkins line? Tell me, you must be known.
Superolateral corner of the acetabulum.
Yeah, okay, fine. It is perpendicular to the Hilgen-Rieners line and at the uppermost part of the acetabulum. What is Shenton's line?
The neck shaft line going through the superior pubic rami.
Yeah, fine. So, usually, the upper femoral epiphysis should be on the inframedial part, okay? Below Hilgen-Rieners line and medial to Perkins line. If it is dislocated, as you can see here, it will be outside that quadrant. Now we are going to spinal orthosis. What is this orthosis? Very simple.
Philadelphia collar.
Very good, very good. Philadelphia orthosis. Now the mnemonic for Philadelphia orthosis is 3 S's and 2 A's. Okay, the 3 S's are sprains, strains, and stable fractures of the cervical spine. Now these are the 2 A's. What are the 2 A's I'm talking about? Quickly, quickly, you must be known this.
So,
tell
me. CD.
Anterior instrumentation.
Yeah, anterior cervical fusion. Okay, and the other one is.
Meniscectomy.
Oh. Yeah, very good. Anterior discectomy. Right. Sure. What is this device?
Skeletal. Oh no, sir.
Cervical. Hello. Cervical.
Hello, sir. Hello, orthosis. Very, very good. Now, hallo orthosis has different parts. First of all, there is a ring and pin area over here. Then we have a west, and then you have uprights connecting the two. Okay. Now what happens is a pin is used to penetrate the skin and the outer skull table, and that is then connected to the west. So it provides very good immobilization. Okay. It is used for unstable fractures and all that in the lower cervical spine.
Sir, do we use hallo orthosis nowadays?
It is actually, I haven't seen it being used at all, but it's very, very important. That's something, it's asked a lot. Okay, so academically speaking, it's very, very important. This device, please. Very good. So it's called Somi brace. Okay. Now, what are the indications of a Somi brace?
Several fractures, ligament.
Actually, fractures. Okay, cervical spine fractures, which are stable. Okay. Now, SOMI, this is a mnemonic I've made. SOMI needs stable fractures and stable ligaments. So if there's an unstable cervical fracture, don't go for a SOMI brace. If there is ligamentous instability along with the fracture, don't go for a SOMI brace. Okay. What is this orthosis? It's also called a jacket, if that's my help.
Minerva jacket.
Now in Minerva jacket, you can immobilize the spine. You can even control the position of the head with respect to the rest of the spine. It is useful for displaced fractures. Okay, it provides perfect immobilization. Okay, very good immobilization provides Minerva jacket. Okay, fine. Now these orthoses, the one on the left and then on the right. First the left one.
Left. Mm-hmm. So TSL. TLSO.
Yeah, that is Taylor's brace. Okay, TLSO.
Yes, sir.
Now, what about the one on the right?
Knight.
Very good. Knight Taylor's brace. Now, supposing you're asked how to take a measurement for this, the pelvic band, if you can see it over here, the lower band, it is supposed to be located midway between the anterior superior iliac spine and the greater trochanter. Okay. And from that midpoint, you take the circumference. Understood. Then for the lower part, that is the thoracic band, you go 2 inches below the lower end of the scapula, and then you take half of the circumference. Then for the extensions that you can see over here, they're supposed to be 2 centimeters below the spine of scapula and up to the pelvic band. Now, how does a Knight Taylor brace differ from a Taylor brace? There are 2 main differences, just tell me.
Side uprights are there.
Yeah, lateral uprights are there. That is what is very important thing there. There is a horizontal thoracic band. Now, what are these orthoses used for?
Entire vertebral body flexion.
Not exactly. That is mid to lower thoracic and lumbar fractures, either because of trauma or pathological. If you actually, we are actually using more V6 to L2 level fractures. Okay. To L2 level fractures for IT level. These two are very easy. We'll go for the left one first. That is? Lumbosacral corset is used for low back pain conditions associated with osteoporosis, spondylosis, spondylosis, malignancy, lumbar strain, sciatica, bad posture, all of those. Okay. What about the one on the right? What is that?
Ash, anterior hyperextension orthosis.
Yeah. Cruciform anterior spinal hyperextension orthosis. Okay. Now there are 2 points here. One is here, this is the sternal pad, and here there's a posterior force being applied. And then we have this pad over here. Here there is again a posterior force being applied. Now there is an anterior force being applied from the back. Okay. So it's a 3-point fixation. Now ideally this point should be half an inch below the this external
manubrium.
Very good. And this one should be half an inch above the pubic symphysis. Now, what are the indications of a crash brace or a ash brace, if you want to call it that? Sorry. Tell me.
Postoperative mobilization.
Usually for mild wedge compression fractures, it can be used also for treating kyphosis and also for painful osteoporotic wedge compression fractures. It is contraindicated in burst fractures. Okay. It is also contraindicated in all conditions where spinal extension can worsen the scenario. Okay, what is this orthosis? There's a clue on the right side. It is used for correcting thoracic scoliosis. Very good. Milwaukee brace. Okay. Now, Milwaukee brace is usually used for correcting upper thoracic scoliosis. It has got a cervical area and a thoracolumbar area. Now, it prevents or restricts the following motions, that is cervical extension, flexion, lateral rotation, and also it prevents the movements of the thoracolumbar spine, but the rotation is not much prevented in the thoracolumbar spine. Milwaukee orthosis, again, is very important academically. It's a dynamic orthosis. It is custom molded and is used for managing scoliosis. Okay, fine. Now we are going to define a prosthesis. I'm sorry, I already defined it. So, prosthesis replacement of a lost anatomy. Before we do prosthesis, what is the difference between an amputation and a disarticulation? Anybody? Amputation and a disarticulation.
Sir, amputation is through the long bones, amputation articulation through the joint.
Very good. Very good, very good. Amputation is removal of a body part through one or both. Articulation is the removal of a body part through a joint. Okay, fine. Now we're going to start off with the different prosthesis. What is the one on the left? The one on the left, please. The white one.
Above knee
is actually layman's term. You have to call it transfemoral. Okay. Yes, transfemoral prosthesis. The one on the left, one on the right is the endoskeletal type. Okay. Now we're going to the next thing. This won't take much time. What is the one on the far left one?
Tibial,
what type?
Endoskeleton.
Very good. What is the one in the middle?
Transtibial exoskeleton type.
Very good. What is the one on the far right? Far right.
Same, sir. Transtibial.
Very good. Symes prosthesis with a medial opening for the bulbous end after a symes amputation. Now we are coming to prosthetic feet. Okay, the one on the left, please. What is it? Satch foot. Very good. What is satch? What is SACH?
Single axis.
No, it's solid ankle cushion. That is where the logic is coming into the equation. Axis is only single, I agree. Only plantar flexion and dorsiflexion is taking place. But satch is solid ankle cushion heel. Okay. Now, satch foot may have formed. It is always used inside shoes. Okay. Now, what is the foot on the right side? Quickly, very easy. Very good. Jaipur foot. Now, satch foot is usually used inside shoes, so it is not much of an option in India, because in India, most people live in villages, and in villages, they don't like to wear shoes. So, Professor P.K. Sethi and his team, they developed a new foot, prosthetic foot, which can be used as a barefoot prosthetic. Okay. They made it from uncured rubber, and they called it a Jaipur. Now, what are the advantages of Jaipur foot compared to the satch foot? First of all, in Jaipur foot, there are formed toes. It's cosmetically better. It is cheap. Okay, it's very, very cheap. It is free actually in India. Okay. And the motion, you said single axis, right? In satch foot only, plantar flexion and dorsiflexion is there. But in satch foot, luckily there is reversion, inversion and all that. So the mobility is much better for a Jaipur foot compared to the satch foot. Understood, right? Any doubt?
No, sir.
No doubt, right? Okay. Another thing about Jaipur foot is, it is very cheap. It is made up of durable and waterproof material. Again, in India, lots of rain is there. Waterproof and durable material as well. Now we are coming to mobility aids. Okay. This is the last part of the talk. Now, mobility aids are devices used by people who have difficulty in walking to ambulate around areas. Okay. Typical example, houses here. Huh? You can see house on the right side. Okay. Now we'll briefly discuss these things. We'll start with this thing. What is this thing? The one in the farm. Wheelchair. It's when you say, you should say complete answer. Okay, it is manual wheelchair.
Manual wheelchair.
Why manual wheelchair is important is there are so many other types of wheelchairs. Okay, there are motorized wheelchairs, there are jaw powered wheelchairs, sit and puff wheelchairs, so many other. So when you say wheelchair, it is say this is a manual wheelchair. Now wheelchair promotes seated mobility for people who have issues with the lower extremity, like lower extremity weakness. Balance issues, low endurance for prolonged ambulation. Okay. Fine. What is the thing in the middle after the wheelchair on the right side?
Auxiliary crutch.
Very good. Auxiliary crutch. We'll be discussing crutches in detail. Okay. So we'll come to that later. What is the other thing? The one on the third thing on the
walker.
Right of the crutch, auxiliary crutch?
Walker.
Yeah, therapeutic walker. Okay. It is used again for offloading. It can be used for offloading after an injury. It can be used for offloading after a surgery. It can be used for old people who are afraid to fall while walking. Okay. It improves the stability slightly. It has 4 points of contact to the ground. Okay. Now, when a mobility aid has contacts with the ground and the number of contacts increases, that means the stability increases. Okay. Now, there is a disadvantage for the therapeutic walker. You can't use it for climbing stairs. That is one thing. And it is restricted. The use is restricted when there are door sills or narrow entrances. Understood. Okay, now what is the thing in house's hand?
Walking stick.
Yes, it's a walking cane. Okay, now walking cane, what it does is it reduces the amount of weight that is borne on an injured lower extreme. If you are actually interested in how much it helps to offload, is around 20%. Okay. Besides this, besides offloading, it can also help to give a sense of confidence and also to increase the stability of the patient. Now, like I said, in walking canes, you can have a tripod cane where there are 3 points of contact to the ground, or a quadrupod cane where there are 4 points of contact to the ground. Okay. Now the area, the hand grip area is supposed to approximately lie at the level of the greater trochanter. Now we are coming to crutches. Okay, on the far left side is an axillary crutch. Now, how do you take measurement for an axillary crutch? That's a very common question that is asked. Tell me, anybody. If you don't know, I'll tell you. Now let's try.
Yeah, 15 centimeters.
Of the
little toe.
Little toe. 15. My reference is 20 centimeters. But the important thing is axillary crutch measurement is taken in the lying down position. Okay. The supine position without the shoes on. And then from the anterior axillary fold, approximately 20 centimeters anterior and lateral to a little toe is how you measure for an axillary crutch. Now for an elbow crutch, and one more thing is there, an axillary crutch, the elbow is supposed to be flexed to approximately 20 to 30 degrees. Okay. Okay, now we're going to the middle one, that is elbow crutch. Tell me about how to measure for an elbow crutch. Tell me. Okay, fine. Again, in the lying down position with the shoes on, in the axillary crutch, there are no shoes in the leg. So for elbow crutch, lying down position with the shoes on, the elbow is flexed to approximately 15 degrees and around centimeters anterior and lateral to the sole. That's how you do it. You have to reassess it in the standing position. And the last one is, what is this picture of a small girl? Last one.
Gutter crutch.
I didn't get you. What crutch? Gutter crutch. Huh?
Gutter crutch or forearm crutch.
Now here you measure this thing actually in the standing position. Okay, elbow flexed to 90 degrees in the distance from the elbow down to the ground. Now these are my references. Okay, we forgot to discuss the common causes of amputation. I actually wanted to discuss it towards the end, so we'll just have a brief discussion on that. What are the common causes of amputation? Tell me, what are the common causes of amputation? Anyone? Pawan, tell me.
Sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, trauma.
Okay. Trauma is one. Then?
Tumor.
Malignancy, yes. Then?
ischemia, that is.
Yeah, peripheral vascular insufficiency is the most common cause. So whenever you're listing out things, always prioritize. Okay, the most common is first peripheral vascular insufficiency, then trauma, then go for malignancy, then go for infection, then go for extremes of temperature leading to burns or frost injury. Okay, then go for congenital absence of a limb or congenital deformation. Okay, fine. Thank you. This is a small assessment that I had planned. If everyone is okay with that, after a 2 minute break, I'll just present that.
Okay, sir.
Can I start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Let's start. Okay, what is this device?
Milwaukee
brace. Very good. Very good. Used for?
Scoliosis.
Very good. What are the different parts?
Consists of a chin pad, occipital pad.
Cervical area. And, cervical area. This is the thoracolumbar area. Okay. Fine. Next one. What is this?
Tripod cane.
Very good. Tripod cane. So tripod when cane. The number contact points increases, the stability increases. Okay. That is a point you remember about tripod. This one.
Finger cord.
Very good. Finger cord splint for any painful finger condition, fractures, pulled ligaments, anything. This one.
Night tailor splint.
You can see the lateral uprights here. Understood. That's night tailor brace, usually used for mid to lower thoracic and lumbar areas. We prefer to use it for T6 to L2 level lesions. It can be traumatic fractures or even pathological fractures secondary to malignancy or anything like that. This one I haven't discussed. This is for the nerdy ones. This is one orthosis I didn't discuss, but it's very important. What?
Swedish.
Very good. Swedish knee case. It is used for which condition?
Recurvatum.
Very good. Very, very good. Okay. Fine. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Binish. It was a very wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
And I think that assessment part also really good. I think we'll ask everybody to have that assessment. What do you say? Divya, you want to say something?
No, sir. I think the assessment part, it will actually make people think.
Yes.
Rather than just being mute.
So we'll meet next week. Thank you. Thank you once again, Binish. Thank you once again, Divya.
Thank you.
Thank you, all the participants. Thank you, Srinivas.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.